And in this group, ma'am. Yes.
Very good morning to all. On behalf of Research Committee of Arasu Engineering College, Kumbakonam, I have a great pleasure in welcoming our Principal Sir, Dr. T. Balamurugan, and Dr. M. Rukmahadan, Dean of Academics, and members of Research Committee to this webinar. A series of webinars are being organized by our college in order to effectively utilize the COVID-19 lockdown. Today, we are very much happy to host webinar on the title, Guidelines for Writing a Research Paper. Our principal, who is having more than 15 years of research experience, is going to share his knowledge and deliver the presentation. I wholeheartedly welcome all the delegates, participants, and my dear friends to join in this webinar. I wish all the participants to session today. Now, let me hand over the session to our principal, sir. Thank you.
Warm water, why is
that? Please.
Yeah, on YouTube.
YouTube lower there.
Okay, very good morning to you all. I am Dr. Balamurugan, Principal of Arasu Engineering College, Kumbakonam, Tamil Nadu. In our college, the research committee is doing lot of research related activities throughout the year. In that, they asked me to share my views about how to write a research paper. So they organized in the form of this seminar through online pedagogy. That is webinar on guidelines for writing a research paper. First, what is a research paper? Normally, the research is finding a new things or doing the things in a different way. So at the outcome of that, we may come with some conclusions. So we have to present that conclusions in the form of a thesis or paper. So that is the research paper. Normally, the research paper can also be referred as scholarly article. The scholarly article means if any article is written by following some standard specifications, then we can say that as the scholarly articles. Normally, this research paper contains the results of original research or the evaluation of research conducted by others. In this paper, we can give what results we arrived from our research work, that we can give, or we can compare our results with the results obtained by other researchers. So that also we can do in this paper. Normally, the scholarly articles will undergo a process of peer review before they can be accepted for publication in an academic journal. These articles are submitted to the academic journal. The journal authorities, they will make a peer review process in that paper, whether it can be accepted for publication or not. The research paper is an essay in which a researcher explains what he learned after exploring his topic in depth. The researcher gives complete details about the work done by him throughout that work. A good research paper should address a specific research question. So here, what is a good research question? The key attributes are specificity, originality or novelty, and general relevance to a broad scientific community. So if any question have these attributes, then we can say that as a very good research question. Here the specificity, so that the question or the work focused by you should have a specific area, and that work is a new one. It should not be copied from others, and that work should be highly useful to the scientific community. In what way the work you are focusing is useful to the community, and in what way it is different from others, and what is the areas. If any question answers for these three, then we can say that is a good research question. Then intentions for writing a research paper. Normally, why we are writing the research paper? What are all the reasons for writing a research papers? Here, there may be some specific reasons. So the first one is, normally the researcher has some results that are worth reporting. After doing that research work, he may come with some conclusions. He may want that conclusion should go to others. He want to report that to others. So that's why the researcher has some results that are worth reporting, and the researcher wants to contribute in the progress of scientific thought. So through this work, he may want to contribute something for the scientific community. The researcher wants his work to reach a broader audience. So it is normally all they want that their work should reach in a broader way. The research will improve the standard of academicians. So the most of the academic personalities, they are continuously doing research works in order to update themselves with the latest. And it is a partial requirement for the award of degree for the scholars. It is mandatory for the research scholars and the PhD scholars that they have to present or publish research paper in peer-reviewed journals. Here the general structure of a research paper. So all the research papers should be organized into specific sections, and each section should have a specific goal. Normally, a good research paper should be structured in the following manner. So what are all the major headings the research paper should have? The first thing is title. Then abstract, next one keywords, introduction, literature review, materials and methods, results, discussion, conclusion, limitations, acknowledgement, references, and finally the appendix. So these are all the major headings that are expected in a good research paper. So we have to present our findings under these major headings. So first thing is the framing the title. Compose a concise and descriptive title. Here, the title is the most important part of our paper, because it draws the reader in and tells them what you are presenting. So once all the readers, they will go through the title only first. Then the title should be clear and interesting, otherwise the reader will not continue reading. So we have to attract the readers from the title itself. Make your title specific enough to describe the contents of the paper. But it should not be so technical that only specialists will understand. So even common man can understand the concept what you are trying to tell through that title. So the title should not contain any technical terminologies. To the maximum possible extent, try to avoid the technical terminologies in the title. So the title should be appropriate for the intended audience. And this title is your first opportunity to attract the reader's attention. Remember here, the first readers are the editors and the reviewers, because before conveying this to the scientific community, we are sending this to the journals. Here, the first readers are the editors and the reviewers. Reviewers will check whether the title is specific and whether it reflects the content of the manuscript. So the title itself, they may get a broad idea about your work. Normally, the editors will hate the titles that make no sense or fail to represent the subject matter adequately. So hence, keep the title informative and concise. So you must avoid technical terminology and abbreviations to the maximum possible extent. Also, readers are the potential authors who will cite your article, so the first impression is powerful. Because after reading your article, the readers, they may cite your work in their presentations. So the first impression from the title is powerful. So the title, normally it describes the subject matter of the article. In general, mostly we are framing the title that describes the subject matter. For example, the effect of spending more time for playing video games on academic performance. Here, we are explaining the effect of spending more time by the students for playing video games on their academic performance. So the same title can be written in a different form. That is, sometimes the title that summarizes the result is more effective. For example, the above title, that can be restructured as students spending more time on playing video games get lower grades. Here, the study, the result obtained from the study is given in the title itself. So sometimes the results given in the title itself will be more effective. A general rule, the title should contain keywords describing the work presented. In that title, try to give the maximum possible keywords which are relevant to your study, because the titles becomes the basis for most online computer searches. If you are searching through computers, we are searching the articles through keywords. So a majority of readers will find your paper via electronic database searches, and those search engines key on words found in the title. So that electronic search engines first will search the keywords in the title. So based on the above points, we must take utmost care while framing the title of our research paper, because the title, the impression on the title is the important one for most of the readers to continue reading our work. Then in the second section is abstract. So we have to write the informative abstract. The abstract is a summary of your research. It is nearly as important as the title, because the reader will be able to quickly read through it. And the abstract is another strategy for refining your thoughts. It is a 200 to 300 word document that provides a short summary or description of your research article. Here, within that 200 to 300 word document, the complete broad idea about your research work should be given. So make it interesting and easily understood without reading the whole article. So once if we read the abstract, it should give complete detail about your research work. The abstract should tell the prospective readers what did you and what are the important findings in your research. So in the abstract, you should give the methodology, what you have done and what are all the expected results. And a clear abstract will strongly influence whether or not your work is further considered by the readers. So once most of the readers, after reading the abstract, they will directly come to a conclusion that whether this work is worth to proceed further or not. So you have to give a clear abstract because it will strongly influence the readers. Moreover, most of the time the abstract is the only part that reader can obtain through electronic literature searches. So in most of the databases, the abstract is available. So the researchers can search through the abstract only. Therefore, enough key information must be included to make the abstract informative. Normally, this abstract is a text file. Use ActiveVoice format and past tense to the maximum possible extent. So you have to frame this by using ActiveVoice and past tense. A simple way to create an abstract is to answer a series of questions. If an abstract answers for the below mentioned questions, we can say that as an informative abstract. The first one is, who are the intended readers? Here, the area should be given. On what area we have done this research work? What did you do? So the problem you are focusing, what you are going to do, that you should give in that. Why did you do? Why you have done this research work? That you should mention. How did you do that? So the methodology, how you have carried out that research work, that should be given. Then next one, what happened when you did that? Here, you should give the observations made during that research work. Then what results mean in theory? So based on that, what results you arrived? So you have to record that results. Then what do you, the results mean in practice? You have to apply the results and you have to compare this results with the practical one. Then what remains unsolved? Here, you must give some scope for future work. So if any abstract answers for these questions, we can say that as an informative abstract. Normally, the abstract should not, contain lengthy background information and references to other literature, incomplete sentences, abbreviations or terms that may be confusing to readers, acronyms and citations, any sort of illustration, figure, table, and references. So these things should not be in the abstract. Normally, how do you know when you have enough information in your abstract? So confirm that all the precise information appearing in the abstract broadly appear in the body of the paper. A simple rule of thumb, imagine that you are another researcher doing a study similar to the one you are reporting. And in that case, if the abstract was the only part, then whether this conveys the required information to you or if you are satisfied with the information given in the abstract. If you are getting full satisfied, then you can come to a conclusion that the abstract gives the information. Then the next section is keywords. Normally provide 4 to 6 keywords which are most relevant to the research work. The keywords given should be relevant to the research work because most of the search engines, they are focusing on the keywords only. The keywords should be separated by semicolons. In electronic searches, the keywords play a major role. Then the next section is introduction. So how to write a compelling introduction? So this is your opportunity to convince the readers that you clearly know why your work is useful. So through the introduction part, you have to convince the readers. A good introduction should answer the following questions. First question is, what is the problem to be solved? Here, begin your introduction by clearly identifying the subject area of interest. So where you are doing this research work, that you should give. So the subject area of interest should be identified clearly. Then establish the context of the work being reported. What you are going to do, that should be specified. Here, organize the information to present the more general aspects of the topic and then narrow toward the more specific topical information. So first, the information should be a broader one. Then you should give a narrow information and then you have to give the statement of purpose. So first the field, then the particular area, and then the particular problem. In that way, from broader to narrower, you have to organize the information. Second question is, are there any existing solutions? So related to your work, is there any previous researches conducted by researchers? Is there any solutions or methodologies available to carry out your work already? Here, what literature should you look for in your review of what we know about the problem? You need to introduce the main scientific publications on which your work is based. So, based on what literatures you have arrived at this title, you have arrived at this problem, or you have arrived at this research question, that you should mention here. Citing a couple of original and important works, including recent review articles, you can refer the scientific publications or some review articles in the introduction section. However, the editors don't like the improper citations of too many references which are irrelevant to the work or inappropriate judgments on your own achievements. So the references cited in the paper should be relevant to the work, and the judgments given in the paper should be relevant to your achievement. So which is the best one? Here, we have to provide a clear statement of the rationale for our approach to the problem studied. So we have framed the problem, and now we are going to solve or get the solution for the problem. The method in which how we are getting solution for that problem is the rationale here. So what are the scientific merits of that particular model system? So you should mention the merits of the method chosen by us here. Why we have chosen that methodology to solve our research problem. What advantages does it confer in answering the particular questions you are posing? Do not discuss here the actual techniques or protocols used in your study. In that introduction portion, just give the methodology, that is enough. You need not give the entire technology or protocol in this section. If you are using a novel idea or methodology, the merits of that new technique or method when compared with the previously used methods should be presented in the introduction section. So if you are using a new technology, you have to give in what way your new technology is superior than the existing technologies, that you should mention. The next one, what is its main limitation? So while doing this research work, you have to provide the relevant theoretical and technical background information for that. Here, is there any technical limitations or any general social limitations, financial limitations, everything you have to briefly mention in that introduction section. What do you hope to achieve? This is nothing but the expected outcome. So by conducting the research work, what may be the expected outcome, that you should give in the introduction briefly. Some additional tips for the introduction. So if you follow these additional tips, then your introduction will give a very good appearance and it will convey the meaning. Never use more words than the necessary. Here it should be concise and to the point. Don't make this section into a history lesson. Long introductions put readers off. The introduction must be organized from the global to a particular point of view. First broadly you explain, then to a specific explanation must be given for your research work. State the purpose of the paper and the research strategy adapted to answer the problem, but do not mix the introduction with the results, discussion and the conclusion. Here the expected outcome must be given, but you need not give the entire results and discussion and conclusion. You need not give in this. And the hypothesis and objectives must be clearly remarked at the end of the introduction. The expressions such as novel, first time, first ever, and paradigm changing are not preferred. Use them sparingly. While framing this introduction section, to the maximum possible extent, use activized statements or sentences. Then after completing this introduction, the next section is review of the literature and the research model. Here, some authors may present the literature materials included in the paper as a separate section under its own heading, and some may present this as a part of longer introduction. So you can give this literature review section as a separate one, or you can include this in the introduction itself. In both the cases, the review of the related literatures should be described and analyzed, the published studies that are directly related to the topic and the research questions at hand. Related literature should be integrated with the material in this section and not be simply cataloged, so that the related literature should be integrated. The review could include with a brief summary of the literatures and their implications. So what are all the research works in that area have been done previously by the researchers, those research outcomes and their implications, that should be given in the literature review portion. So focus your efforts on the primary research journals that publish original research articles. So the literature, what you are choosing, it should be from a highly reputed peer-reviewed journals. Sometimes you may read some general background references. For example, the encyclopedias, textbooks, lab manuals. From these resources, you may get some ideas. But to the maximum possible extent, do not try to cite these general references, because the general references may contain information that are considered fundamental or common knowledge within the discipline. Review articles are particularly useful because they summarize all the research done on a narrow subject area over a brief period of time. So researchers try to collect more review articles to the maximum possible extent, because those review articles will give you lot of ideas in that narrow field. Then after writing this literature review section, the next section is materials and methods. In this section, you should explain clearly how you carried out your study. So already in the title and abstract, we framed the objective and we explained, briefly explained the methods, how to reach the results. In materials and methods section, we have to clearly explain how we have carried out the experiment. If the research work is proposing a new method, it should be included with the detailed information so a knowledgeable reader can reproduce the experiment. Suppose if you are introducing or proposing a new method, means complete information about that new method should be given, because that may be highly useful for other researchers to reproduce that experiment. Do not repeat the details of established methods. Suppose if you are using the already established methods, at the time you need not give complete details about those already established methods. Here, just simply referring those methods, that is enough. If you had a complicated protocol, suppose in that methodology, if it is very complicated, at that time you may include a diagram, table, or flow charts to explain the methods you used. So in that case, you can use either diagram, table, or flow charts. Do not put results in this section. In the materials and methods section, don't put the results. You may, however, include preliminary results that were used to design the main experiment that you are reporting on. Some special situations, we may include the preliminary results in that materials and methods section. For example, what are all the preliminary results? For example, in a preliminary study about the pollutants emitted by automobiles. So here the study is, I'm going to study about the pollutants emitted by automobiles. For that, I observed that the vehicle's movement for 1 week on a highway and found that 40% of them between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. So here, I observed the vehicle movement for 1 week, and what I got, my result is 40% of them between 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. This is a preliminary result. So this result I am using. So I conducted all subsequent experiments between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. So why I have conducted the experiments between 8 a.m. to 10 a.m. for that, I have given that preliminary result. So such type also followed. Then you may use the active voice to a certain extent, although this section requires more use of third person passive constructions than others. So to the maximum possible extent, try to use the active voice statements. Avoid use of first person in this section. While framing the sentence, try to avoid the usage of first person. Remember to use the past tense throughout, since the work being reported was already done and was performed in the past, not in the future. So it should be given in past tense form. So the following are some of the points to be considered: when and where the study was carried out. In that materials and method section, we have to answer for this when and where the study was carried out. For field study work, provide a description of the study site. So if you are conducting any survey related or field study work, then the study site, the description of the study site must be provided. For experimental work, we have to give the description of the experimental setup with the detailed specifications. If you are doing any kind of experimental research work, at that time, the complete specifications of the experimental setup must be given. Provide the protocol for collecting data. So the data collection protocol must be given, and include how the data were analyzed. So the collected data, how we analyzed those collected data, that should be included. Briefly, in this section, include the flowcharts or algorithms used, the statistical softwares used, if any, and statistical tests conducted for arriving the results, then numerical and our graphical techniques used to analyze the data. Those things you have to briefly include in the materials and methods section. Then by following that methodology, we got some results. That results should be presented and discussed, because that was our expected outcome. Sometimes you may use a single section to both present and discuss the results. And sometimes you may deal the two issues in two separate sections. So sometimes we can present both the results and discussion under a single heading, or sometimes we may present these in two different headings. In both the cases, the statistical techniques that were applied to the data must be mentioned, and the results of each analysis should be summarized, tabulated, and then discussed. So here, in the results presentation section, what we have to concentrate. The function of the result section is to objectively present your key results without any interpretation. Here, simply you have to give the results what you obtained from the experiment or from the methodology. Here, you should not give any interpretation. That key results should be orderly and logical sequentially should be presented. Here, you may use both text and illustrative materials. In order to present the result, you may use the text or illustrative materials. Here, the illustrative materials are tables and figures. In the form of tables and figures or graphs, you can explain. Write the text of the result section concisely and objectively. Then the passive voice will likely dominate here, but use the active voice as much as possible. The result section should be written to the maximum possible extent by using the active voice format. Use past tense here. And avoid repetitive paragraph structures. Do not interpret the data here. Each table or figure must be discussed in the body of the text, referred to by its number. So whatever figure or table you are discussing, that should be referred by its number in the body of the text. Figure number and title should be left aligned always and placed directly below the figure. The footnote should be given directly below the figure. For tables, the table number and title should be left aligned and placed directly above the table. For figures, it should be below the figure, and for table, it should be above the table. An important issue is that you must not include references in this section. While presenting your results, you should not mention any references, because you are presenting your results, so you should not refer the results of others here. Most of the authors, they are doing some mistakes in this portion. While for justifying their results, they are including some references. So in the result section, don't include the references. That references can be included in the discussion section. Some problems to avoid. Do not reiterate each value from a figure or table, only the key result or trends that each conveys. So in that result section, don't give vague expressions. Just give the key results or the trend what you arrived from those. That is enough. Do not present the same data in both the table and figure. So the table and figure should not convey the same data. Suppose if it is like that, then it is redundant and waste of space and energy. So decide which format best suitable for presenting the result and choose that. So either by using table or by using figure. which one will give clear picture about our research work, that you choose. Do not report a raw data which require further processes for arriving the results. In that result section, you should not give any raw data, because the readers, they will not do further processes for arriving the results. Then next session is discussion. The function of the discussion session is to interpret our results in light of what was already known about the subject of the investigation, and to explain our new understanding of the problem after taking our results into consideration. Here, we have to discuss what results we arrive. For that, we have to use active voice whenever possible. The discussion section should be organized to address each of the experiments or studies for which you presented the results. So the discussion section, here you have to elaborately discuss what are all the results presented by you in the result section. Discuss each in the same sequence as presented in the results. So what the results you presented in the result section, in the same sequence, you have to discuss all the results. Each result should be discussed in terms of the original hypothesis to which it relates, and in terms of its agreement or disagreement with the results obtained by other researchers in similar or related studies. Here, you have to compare the result obtained by you with the original hypothesis existing, or with the outcome arrived by some other researchers already in the same field. So by referring the references, or by referring the literatures, you have to justify what results you arrived here. Here, you can give your agreement or disagreement with the results obtained by the earlier researchers. If the results are consistent with the theoretical model, researchers' expectations, and our findings of other researchers, explanation must be provided as to what the results mean and what their theoretical and practical implications. Here, suppose if you are getting the expected results, then we have to explain the theoretical and practical implications here. Sometimes we may not get the expected results. Our findings may be in the negative directions. So that is, when the results do not support the hypothesis and are contradict with the previous findings, not only in their meanings, but also possible reasons for the discrepancies must be discussed. So we are conducting the experiment or we are conducting the research work. Suppose the outcome of the research work is contradict with the previous findings, or it is not supporting the original hypothesis, at that time, we have to clearly explain the meaning as well as the possible reasons for the discrepancies. The 14 steps for which an effective discussion section. So if any discussion section is considering the below mentioned 14 steps, then we can say that as an effective discussion part. So organize the discussion from the specific to general, that is researcher findings to literature, to theory, to practice. First, what is the result? Then in what way it is related to the literatures, and in what way it is related to the practice theory, and how it will be useful to the public. So in that way, from a narrower level to a broader level, that discussion should be given. Use the same key terms, the same verb tense, and the same point of view that you used when describing the problem in the introduction. So here, try to consider what you have written and what format you followed for presenting the introduction portion. Begin by restating the hypotheses that were tested and answering the questions posed in the introduction. Support the answers with the results. Explain how the results relate to expectations and to the literature, clearly stating why they are acceptable and how they are consistent or fit with the previously published knowledge, that is previously published research articles. Address all the results relating to the questions, regardless of whether or not the findings were statistically significant. What are all the questions addressed? For all those things, you have to give the results. Describe the patterns, principles, and relationship shown by each major finding or result. The sequence of providing this information is important. First, state the answer, then the relevant results, then cite the work of others. Discuss and evaluate conflicting explanations of the results. This is the sign of a good discussion. So the conflicting explanations will give you a conclusion that you are having a clear idea about that. Discuss any unexpected findings. When discussing an unexpected finding, begin the paragraph with the findings and then describe it. Identify potential limitations and weaknesses and comment on the relative importance of these to your interpretation. Summarize concisely the principal implications of the findings, regardless of statistical significance. Then provide the recommendations for the research work. Explain how the results and the conclusions of this study are important and how they influence our knowledge or understanding of the problem being expanded. In the writing of the discussion, discuss everything but be concise, brief, and specific. Take into the following tips. While writing the discussion, avoid statements that go beyond what the results can support. Avoid unspecific expressions. Broad expressions should be avoided. The unspecific expressions such as higher temperature at a lower rate, highly significant like that. Here, the quantitative descriptions must be always preferred. Avoid a sudden introduction of new terms or ideas. So you should not introduce new terms or ideas in the discussion section. It should be included in the introduction section itself. Speculations on possible interpretations are allowed, but these should be rooted in fact rather than imagination. Merely by having imagination, that speculations should not be included. Then after giving a detailed discussion, you should give a concise conclusion. Conclusion section summarizes the study's findings in an easy to understand manner. It explains the practical implications of the findings. It also yields the points to be recommended and the directions for future research in that area. In that conclusion section, you should give briefly what the final outcome and what you are trying to tell through this final outcome. That you must give in the conclusion section. Normally, the elements to be included in the concluded section: state the study's major findings, explain the meaning and importance of the findings, relate the findings to those of similar studies, consider alternative explanations of these findings, state the clinical relevance of the findings, acknowledge the study's limitations, make suggestions for further research. So these elements should be included in the conclusion section. And limitations. So what are all the limitations while doing this research work? We have to discuss any study limitations. Here, the technical limitations, social limitations, legal limitations, financial limitations, if any, that should be given here. And you should suggest additional studies also. Then next section is acknowledgement. after presenting the results, conclusion, everything, you have to acknowledge all the contributors. Here, the motivators from whom you may get ideas and supports, the technical supporters and financial supporters. So you have to acknowledge all the contributors for your work. Then you should give the reference section. In the text, you must cite all the scientific publications on which your work is based. Normally, some 50 to 60 references may be included for original research articles. What are all the references included in the reference section? That should be cited in the body of the text. But do not overinflate the manuscript with too many references. So even if you provide more number of references, that will not serve the purpose, or that may give contradiction with the conclusion. Avoid excessive self-citations and excessive citations of publications from the same region. Then next section is appendix. Some examples of material that might be put in an appendix. Suppose if you are giving a lot of data to be presented, then it is not possible to include those things in the body of the text. At that time, we can supplement those data or details in the appendix form. Here, the raw data, maps, extra photographs, any explanation for formulas, specialized computer programs used for the particular procedure, figures and tables. So these things may be given in the appendix. In general, now we have constructed the research paper, but some of the additional tips we have to follow. In general, for figures, while drawing the figure, there are two main color models. First one is RGB model and another one is CMYK model. Here RGB stands for red, green, blue, and CMYK stands for cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. Most of the microscopes will take images using the RGB model. However, CMYK is the standard used for printing. For printed version, the CMYK model is used. So to the maximum possible extent, try to compose your figures by using this CMYK model. For tables, you have to give clear and concise legend or caption, and the data should be divided into categories for clarity, and sufficient spacing must be given around the columns and the rows. The units should be provided for the data used in that table, and the table should have a legible font type and size. A strong manuscript should have a good content, should be novel, useful, and exciting. It should have good presentation. It should be able to grasp the scientific significance easily by the reviewers and editors. The following are some of the major features for possible rejection of your article by the reviewers and editors. So if your research article is lacked in sufficient scientific interest, that is the results with lack of scientific interest, and if your work is outdated, that is outdated work, or duplication of work already published, if the research article contains incorrect data, or the conclusions not supported by the data, there is a major chance for possible rejection. So 10 characters of an incredibly dull paper. So if a paper is avoiding focus and avoiding originality and personality, making the article really too long, not indicating any potential implications, leaving out the illustrations, omitting necessary steps of reasoning, using abbreviation and technical terms that only specialists in the field can understand, making it sound too serious with no significant discussion, focusing only on statistics, supporting every statement with the help of reference. If a paper is in this format, then we may treat this as a dull paper. Then after doing all these things, just to make a checklist. So once if you have drafted your research paper, go over this checklist to ensure that it is ready for submission to the peer-reviewed journals. The first thing is, does your paper fulfill all of the requirements that the assignment asked for? Did you stick to a topic that fits the assignment, the problem statement? Are your sources credible, reliable, and logical? The background information and the literature. Do you have a clear, arguable thesis statement? Is your paper organized in a logical way that is easy to understand? Did you plagiarize? Did you proofread the content and grammar improvements and errors? Is your paper properly formatted, depending upon the journal's requirements? Are you prepared to submit correctly? So after writing the research article, just you make these checklists. Finally, the publishing may be hard, but it is worth at the end. Good luck and happy publishing. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, please go.
Questions.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. I am Prakash Tiwari from Mumbai, and I am civil engineer and MBA. Sir, please provide this PPT on email IDs or WhatsApp group.
No, this PPT will be given on the WhatsApp group.
Okay, okay. Thank you, sir. And take one more.
So thank you. From
thesis. How to write thesis?
So the thesis, because in a research article, just we are focusing only one problem and what's any that? One methodology. In a research article, we are focusing any one problem by applying any one methodology.
Anyone?
Yes. For a particular work, by using a particular methodology.
Okay, okay.
But while writing thesis, it is a massive work. You may compare number of methodologies for a number of problems. So while writing
number
a
of problems, different types of problem.
Yes, different types of problems by different adopting different problems. Methodologies.
Right.
So for each and every type of problem analyzed, you have to give a separate chapter in the thesis.
Right.
While writing a thesis, you have to give a separate chapter for each and every problem discussed by a particular method.
Technical and non-technical, both?
Yes, both.
Both.
Because in the introduction chapter, you have to give what are all the criterias or categories, or what are all the different approaches you are going to do. Those things you should mention, and you have to elaborately explain those things in different chapters.
In different types of categories. Chapters.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Anybody else? Feel free to raise your doubts. So if no more questions, I sincerely express my heartfelt thanks to the research committee of Arasu Engineering College for making this great event. Thank you.
Whether my voice is audible? Hello, sir. Whether my voice is audible? Hello? Hello? Whether my voice is audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir, thank you, sir. Respected resource person, come principal of our institution, beloved vice principal, research committee members, head of the departments, staff members, and my dear participants. Good afternoon to all. Myself, Dr. M. Rukmagadan, Dean of Academics of this institution. Today, we had an excellent webinar on guidelines for writing research papers. The resource person has given some valuable ideas and tips to transform our research findings into research papers. On behalf of our management and research committee members, and on my personal ground, I express my heartiest thanks to the resource person for the valuable guidelines given to us. As the outcome of this webinar, more and more research papers with high quality will get published in future. For that, your guidelines will be foundation. Thank you, sir. There are no words to express our thanks to our vice principal for the ideas and the constant support given to us to organize this webinar. Personally, my special thanks go to the research committee people for the initiative works and the efforts taken by them to bring out this webinar in a successful manner. Last but not least, without the cooperation of the participants, this webinar cannot become success. So I express my heartfelt thanks to all the participants. There is one information for all the participants. After this meeting is